Good afternoon. Today we'll speak about California and how it adapts to changes and risk. What you will learn is a little bit about California agriculture and a little bit about how to think about the changes and what they imply to supply chain and what they imply to studying industries in general and agriculture in particular. Agriculture and the economy is operating in a dynamic era where things are changing. And in order to survive, you have to adapt. What we will discuss today is some of the risks that face agriculture, some of the main processes of change that affects it, and how California agriculture is adapting to the change. Let's start to think. When we speak about risk, what do we mean? Generally, the main, a good measure of risk is variation around the mean. How much things are varying from the mean. But risk is asymmetric. If you're a producer, you are really worried about downside risk, and you don't care that much about upside risk, where things are better. Actually, you like it. So, to some extent, variation matters, but there is more weight to the losses than the gains. That's what is called loss aversion. Now, you may have a situation where you have acceptable risks, maybe prices are 10% of the normal, or acute risk, where prices are very low and income is very low. And when you have a acceptable risk, when things are slightly below the normal, or even more than slightly, you can adjust by insurance, draw money out of the bank, but if you have a severe risk, then you need government intervention, you need the structural adjustment. But when you think about your paradigm, you have to recognize the different type of risk are possible. You have to be ready to handle the day-to-day normal risk, but then you have also to be ready to think what will happen if the bad outcome occur, if we have an acute situation. How much risk do are farmers exposed to? A lot of risk from your impression?
Just gonna say, I don't know how anybody can get anything to grow. There's just so many things that can go wrong. Pests and nematodes and lack of water, too much water, frost, many things that can happen. We basically saw all the things, you know, all the pestilence, you know, the various types of pests, the things that can happen to the roots. There's just so many things that can happen. And then there's sort of the specter of climate change, you know, changing the number of growing hours, and there's plenty of things that can go. There's a lot of risk in agriculture.
There are different type of risk. Risk about yield, how much output you get. It may be result of drought, it may be affected by drought, pest infestation, etc. Risk associated with output prices, input prices, availability of labor, technology, new technology that may not work, policy and regulation, suddenly we have a change in regulation. You cannot hire workers or you cannot use a chemical. Availability of markets and risk about product quality. All these risks affect producers and consumers and require adjustment. Some risks can be addressed better than others. For example, price risk can be addressed by future market. Yield risk can be addressed by crop insurance. Then we have revenue assurance that can address both. Sometimes changes in income can be addressed by using your bank account. But other risks that are more physical risk, accidents that can hurt you, cannot be addressed very well. So you have to be protecting yourself. One big challenge is to adapt to changes that may threaten your business, that threaten your opportunity, and may threaten your life. And we'll speak about what type of changes we have and then how to address them. Now, what are the main sources of change that we have? People speak about climate change, but this is only one among many. There are economic changes. There are political changes. Trump may be president, maybe Hillary. There are droughts. There are international relationships. There may be a crisis in China or in the Middle East. So there are a lot of changes that affect economic system. And then there are changes in taste, changes in technology. We basically live in an era of revolutionary technologies that affect what products are available and what type of marketing system we have. And consumers' belief and preferences are changing. Population and income growth is a major force that affects agriculture, and when it comes to California agriculture, it's for the better. If we have now 7 billion people, we expect to have 9 to 12 billion people in the future. They would like to eat, their income will grow, so we will need in 20 to 30 years about 70% more food. So food producers know that in the long run, demand will increase. If demand goes faster than supply, output price will increase. If supply outpaces demand because of innovation that will be faster than technological change, then prices go down. In any case, every region has to take into account that they have to increase their productivity to be able to take advantage of new opportunities and capture output price and survive in case that prices go down. Climate change, by definition, is a source of changes. One of these changes is weather will be more unstable, more drought and more period of high frequency rainfall. The California snowpack in the Sierra is already declining, which means that we'll have to manage better our water resources and we may not be able to irrigate as much. So we have to think about our water system. Now, another thing that I worry about is that the warm temperatures are moving north. And when it moves north, it has a lot of implication. And you don't need about big, drastic change to have big implication. Pests may migrate. One pest that, and my migrating pest can destroy a lot of crops unless you have a solution that can be obtained by IPM or GMOs. You may suddenly have warmer temperature and then crop cannot, yield will go down because you have less blooming. So you need to develop technologies to deal with it. And if temperature goes up too much, then probably you have to switch system, let's say from Napa towards Mendocino. So one of the big challenges in the long run is sometimes relocating agricultural complexes. And it's not only the farms, it's the agribusiness, it's the processes, is everything else. Rising water level may cause some problem and loss the cost. It may cause some trouble to some of the ports. So we'll have to change our infrastructure. But in the short run, the main concern that I have is about more unstable weather and small and some changes in production in the in production pattern. In the long run, the impact will be much more drastic. What do you think are the unique features of California agriculture from your experience?
Unique features? All the variety of crops that we grow, all the specialty crops, the fact that we're growing lots of interesting small crops, like blueberries and things like that. I also think it's interesting that we have stuff like rice.
Well, that we have still rains and cars, people don't realize it.
Yeah.
What technology was the most fascinating?
The technology?
What was most fascinating?
I think the drip irrigation, how precise you can be with irrigating, exactly the amount that the plant needs. There was one study where they were measuring the width of the trunks like the less than a millimeter, and you could tell like what status the tree was in terms of water.
One of the major challenges that the California agriculture is facing is water. Almost every 10 years we had a major drought. In 76, 77, in 87 to 91. Then from 91 till about 2012, we really have more or less a period that was rather where there was sufficient water. So what really happened is that generally drought period are period of adjustment. During the 76-77, we start seeing the use of conservation and drip irrigation. During 87 to 91, we start having the water market, and now people start to think about modernizing groundwater. So recognizing that in the future we will have big changes in water availability means that you have to develop a system that is able to cope in drought. And this is not only a system, this is not only true to a farmer, but for a supplier, because if suddenly you don't have a supply of lettuce, you need to find another source. If you cannot have the fruit here, you need to think about how you protect yourself in the market. The another interesting point is, which is very important, is the water cost as share, water cost as share of cost. This is the indicator of how much waste you have in water use. So in crop like sunflower, alfalfa, pasture, alfalfa, water use are very much high share of the cost. In strawberry, grape, almonds, oranges, water use don't matter that much. So what we would like to do is to have the water grow to high value crop rather than low value crop. People complain that a lot of water go to almond, but look at it, almond produced $6 billion of value, much more than alfalfa that consume much more water. So to me, you have to look at what does the water produce, but rather how much water a crop is consuming. Solving, how do you see solving U.S. trying to address this problem, so you can mitigate climate change, but...
Yeah, we're definitely seen as leaders globally, and so I think we can be much more assertive in the changes that we make in accordance with the Paris Agreement. Mm. It's great that we've already signed, and now China and Brazil have also signed on, but we can be even more aggressive in addressing climate change, and I really would... pressure the candidates for a president right now to be adamant about ending our dependency on fossil fuels.
Adaptation to climate change and mitigation of climate change would lead to policy that eventually will increase the price of energy or the dependent on greenhouse gas emitting energy. The price of fuel will go up because of carbon tax or because of cap and trade or other policies. It may not happen now, but it will happen sometime. California is committed to reduce greenhouse gases. So which means that California agriculture has to be much less energy dependent, has to be more green, reduce its emission. And this is a big challenge, how to move to a less greenhouse gas dependent agriculture and be profitable. And that is the main source of opportunity, and it's a main challenge. Some farmers may actually benefit directly from a concern about climate change by introducing solar energy on their land, by adopting technology that sequester carbon. I personally believe that there will be a role for biofuel. And so to some extent, climate change is a main challenge and an opportunity. In California agriculture, energy is also important because of the cost of pumping water. High energy costs affect the cost of water directly. So that's one type of change that one has to be ready to. As I said before, energy prices now are low, but they may go up sooner or later.
Food and climate change are so interrelated, because food has such an immense impact on the environment, our water use, how much greenhouse gases we're putting out into the atmosphere, namely through our consumption of animal products, through meat and dairy, and 46% of California's water goes to animal agriculture. In comparison, only 4% goes to municipal citywide use. That is huge. And so crops like alfalfa that go to feed livestock use an immense amount of water. And so for me, I think that a shift that we can make towards consuming more plant foods and less animal foods, we can decrease our environmental impact drastically. And that goes again for deforestation as well. 90% of Amazon deforestation is due to animal agriculture, cutting down trees, which are sequestering carbon, in order to plant corn and soybeans to feed cows or to graze cows themselves.
There are other concerns. For example, nitrate associated with the use of fertilizer, or nitrate associated with animal waste that contaminate groundwater. Air pollution that is associated with many agricultural activities, damage associated with pesticide drift, problem associated with use of water in agriculture that may prevent water availability by the fish. If we have a lot of rain, no problem, but you have a drought, farms and the fish suffer. The more concerned are they about the environment, the tougher are the regulations that affected agriculture. So agriculture has to be ready and prepared toward these changes.
How do you feel about imported good and local food versus non-local food?
That's a very complicated question. I love cheese and from France and Italy and Germany, and I love imported food. I do. I think that it's better if you eat food that is locally grown. However, sometimes you get a better thing from somewhere else, right? A cow in other parts of the world is a happier cow than some of the cows that are right here in California. The whole local movement is interesting, but it's always too dogmatic. Everybody gets too dogmatic about what they're talking about. And those same people are eating quinoa. We know that's not locally grown.
People care about taste, nutritional content, ease of preparation, price, how the food was prepared. Now, these concerns pose a challenge, but also pose opportunity, because people will be ready to pay more for diversified product. But if you are not prepared, you are in trouble. So you really have to prepare yourself and to be able to change with consumer demand. If consumer demand would like reduce use of pesticide, you have to replace pesticide. If they are concerned about GMO, you have to deal with it. If GMO provide new type of flavor, you have to deal with it as well. So to some extent, dealing with consumer is a big, big challenge. A related issue is that we develop a lot of niche market for specialty crop. People identify different crops from different locations around the world. They identify new flavor. There is a huge demand for ethnic food, Asian food, Middle Eastern food, African food. So if you can bring and grow the food that can meet a niche market and have some monopoly power there, the better. And if you use the food that starts in one region and move it elsewhere, that's an opportunity. California has several interesting success stories. Avocado. Avocado was grown in Mexico, but California popularized it. So we have a huge region of avocado production in Southern California near San Diego, and to some extent, a lot of marketing schemes, a lot of promotions through recipes make avocado part of the day-to-day life of consumers all around the world.
And now, do you worry about supply risk? How you deal with?
I just worry about how I'm going to pay for it. it's expensive buying organic stuff. But I don't worry about that. I worry about so many other things. I probably should worry about it, but I don't.
But this is their problem. It's not your problem.
Correct.
Because you are operating with supermarkets that expect your product on time, if you miss the delivery because of drought, because of a strike, because of flood, you are losing, so you have to be prepared. You have to make sure that your equipment is working. And at the same time, you may need to prepare redundancy. If you're a supplier and you have a good relationship with the supermarket, you need to make sure that if you cannot deliver, there is a way to obtain it from another source. On the other hand, you also have to be flexible enough and agile enough to realize that if there is a shortage in a certain market and you have the material, you can move there. So to some extent, you need to develop a system that is flexible. You need to be working with information systems that are effective in order to take advantage of opportunities and to reduce the exposure to risks. A key element of modern agriculture is heterogeneity, because there are differences in climate, human capital, land quality, infrastructure between regions that result to specialization. So for example, the Salinas Valley is the salad bowl of the world. In California, Napa is where the high quality wine grows, and Northern California is where you have the mass production of wine near Modesto and Gallo. The peaches and stone fruit are grown in some areas near Fresno. Apples are grown in Washington State and in Northern California. Different regions have different capabilities, and a region that increases its capability and attracts more fruits become better off. For example, near the city of Lodi in California, suddenly you grow a lot of cherry in the last several years, and that makes the area much more attractive. So you really have to recognize your heterogeneity and your uniqueness. You really have to recognize your uniqueness and to build a production system that's based on it. You also need to partner. So one of the things that is happening in California is that California farmers may have branches in other regions, in Arizona and in Mexico, so to overcome the time limitation of production and be able to supply a buyer with product throughout the year. So we really have integrated system, and to me, California, Arizona, Northern Mexico are one region that provide a lot of fruit and vegetables to take advantage of the differences among regions. Another big change is industrialization of agriculture. Agriculture now using more automation, more equipment, and the industrialization is not only in farming, but throughout the supply chain. In lettuce, for example, we move from a system that things were done in a manually, very slowly, and the ability to send the lettuce was limited, to system where we have complex lettuce harvesters that the fruit is cut and packed in the field. It is moved to trucks that are basically weather controlled on the field, and then they are sent. So now we can have lettuce that can survive 14 days. Moreover, we have now salad ready fruits and vegetables that are a huge improvement. They reduce the waste, they increase the value added, and the consumer are ready to pay much more from that. To some extent, you realize that what the consumer care is the final product. So if on the farm or near the farm, you can increase the value added to consumer, it's an opportunity. So today, a farm is more than producer of raw fruit or raw vegetable. It may be a first step in the supply chain that then process it and ships the product. There are several key elements of the emerging agriculture. One is new technologies that make a difference. Precision farming. With satellite, remote control, better computer, we are now knowing better what and where everything is, and we have technologies that basically would reduce the cost of production, improve the information we have, increase productivity, and increase environmental quality. Now, if you don't adapt to these technologies, you may lose because others adapt and the standard will be more strict. But you need to adapt in a way that is profitable. So you need to know what these technologies are about and how to deal with them. If we look at the evolution of land use in California over time, and I have the data till 2001, what we see is that the high value crop, which are fruits and vegetables, go up, and the other crop, wheat and corn and cotton go down. So you have a big change moving from low value crop to high value crop. So generally speaking, as the demand for high value crop increase, as the demand for fruit and vegetable increase, farmers shift from the commercial commodities, wheat, corn, rice, towards high-value crop, fruits and vegetables. Altogether in California, relative to other regions, there is a lot of cropland. It's 40%, while pasture is 60%. In other regions, you may have much more pasture, the share of pasture may be higher. Now, the reason that we have high amount, our share of cropland is California is basically a desert, and they brought a lot of water to the desert to irrigate it because the sun, the high temperature, and the dryness are assuring production with relatively few pests. So we have a system that has relatively a large amount of area that goes to crop, and this area is a basically, this area is a source of strength of California agriculture. But much of this area is very vulnerable because it's desert that was converted to agricultural land by water project. This is different than with the Midwest, that is basically rain-fed agriculture. In 2013, we produced close to $50 billion. About 40% was fruits, $20 billion. Another about 15% was vegetables. Another 15 to 20% was livestock. And the rest went between field crop, flowers, etc. So you basically have a very big agriculture, and agricultural sector in California is the largest. Out of this $50 million, there was about $10 million that was gross profit, but then you have to deduct all the expenditure. You really speak about tropic profit rate of about 2 or 3%. Another pattern that we have seen in the last 50 years is privatization. The role of the state is declining. A lot of activities that have done by the state are moved to the private sector. In the United States, the state is very strong in terms of extension still, and we support agricultural research. In other countries, extension has been privatized. But even here, support for extension declined. The role of the state in terms of water is declining more and more. Water infrastructure around the world moved to the private sector. Obviously, what happened in China and other countries is that the private sector is increasing. Private sector play a major role in transportation. And the reason is that the private sector a lot of time can raise funds better than the public sector. There is a limit how much you can tax, and sometimes it can perform better, even though I'm a big believer that the effectiveness of the public sector in many cases is underappreciated. Another area where privatization is very important is technology development. We still have the educational industrial complex where universities provide a lot of innovation that then are upscaled, developed, commercialized, and all this upscaling is done by the private sector. But technology and technology development will continue. We see automation, we see mechanization, now we see the new development in biology, and all these changes really affect California agriculture and affect farmers. The role of government is important. It takes taxes, but spent for public good, for transportation, for infrastructure, for research. It's also an arbitrator between groups. It establishes standards that reduce conflict. It aims to establish standards that reduce transaction costs. Organic standard in California is one example. It's also established quality standard and improve environmental quality. Working with government, making understanding government regulation, sometimes influencing government regulation, is a challenge of any groups operating in agriculture. And now you don't only need to work with one government, you have to meet with other governments. You need to work with the government in China to be able to sell your product there. So to some extent, if you want to take advantage of opportunity and address risk, you need to know what government does and work with them. The thing about globalization, I really believe that globalization is problematic, but it's also a tool for peace. The way that we can deal with the challenge of growing population around the world is to provide people in different countries opportunities to export and to sell. For example, I was in Peru, and Peru has incredible amount of product, wool, fruits, agricultural product, as well as industrial product that they can sell. And when they can sell, the population there is doing better off. Now, for example, they start exporting quinoa to Costco and other companies in California. So if you have a grain from the Andes that is exported everywhere, suddenly the farmers in the Andes and the natives in the Andes have more income, they can send their kids to school, and it results in a situation that they are happier, the war is in better shape, and they are much less, they have more stake in keeping peace around the world. So to some extent, I really believe that globalization, with all its problems, with all the bitterness that it may generate, is a source for good. Every time that historically, where we start having a situation where countries close borders, the next thing was that they start war. It's not that globalization will assure peace, I'm not naive, but globalization is a mechanism for some sort of a peaceful coexistence between countries. Now, the key is to have agreement and rules that are fair. The challenges, for example, of climate change is how to have rules that are accepted by all nations in front when we tackle a common challenge. And it's difficult, but if we don't do it together, we will be much worse doing it, going our separate ways.